Everybody say, Lord, help me. Listen. Lord, 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 please help me. Come on, some of you remember it. Horn section, help me. Oh, Lord. I need you to help me.
Help me to
walk until my chain.
I can
my
chain.
Come. Break it down. I got a verse. My way may not be easy. You did not say that it would be. Remember this part. It's dark, can't see my way. Hey.
Tell me to mend my
dress. Tell me to mend my
dress.
And hey, that's why I'm asking you now, yeah. Please
help
me to walk. Can I get a witness? Hold on.
Pray that you are staying safe and staying well. Grateful that we're able to still fellowship together in Bible study. Never would I imagine that we would have Bible study inside my home, but here we are, 2021, and this Arctic blast has afforded us this privilege. So tonight we'll continue in our study in Psalm 119. For our time together, we'll look at verses 145 through 152. Psalm 119, verses 145 through 152. We'll pray, then see what God has to say to us in tonight's lesson. God, we thank you for this privilege of studying your word. We thank you that your word never fails. Thank you that you've kept us from both dangers seen and unseen as we're trekking through these historic times. God, tonight as we fellowship in your word, show us those things you'd have us to see. Speak those things you'd have us to hear. Teach us what you'd have us to learn so we can be who you've called us to be. More importantly, do what you've called us to do. Even now, Lord, sit Michael down. Allow them to see and hear Jesus, not me. Lord, I need your spirit once again. Anoint me afresh. That your word go forth with accuracy and clarity. That your people be edified and you be glorified. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen. Again, for our time together tonight, we'll look at Psalm 119, verses 145 through 152. From the English Standard Version, it reads, "With my whole heart I cry, answer me, O Lord. I will keep your statutes. I call to you, save me that I may observe your testimonies. I rise before dawn and cry for help. I hope in your words. My eyes are awake before the watches of the night, that I may meditate on your promise. Hear my voice according to your steadfast love. O Lord, according to your justice, give me life. They draw near who persecute me with evil purpose. They are far from your law. But you are near, O Lord, and all your commandments are true. Long have I known from your testimonies that you have founded them forever. So we look at these verses tonight. The context is found in verses 151 and 152, the truthfulness of God's word. In verse 151, the psalmist declares that God's commandments are true. In verse 152, he says that God founded his word forever, that they are established through eternity. Time cannot erase, nor ages destroy, the truthfulness of God's word. If God said it, it's true. That provides us with both a warning and a comfort, because if God said it as a warning, that means it's true. God said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. May not happen in the time frame you think it will, but the fact that God said it means that it's true, that God repays and offers vengeance on the behalf of his children. But it's also a comfort, because it reminds us that whatever God promises, it's true. That no matter what God says, as long as God says it, God is true to his word. That's the lesson I hope we gain from tonight's Bible study. Hope in the truth of God's word. Hope in the truth of God's word. We're dealing with this historic time, especially across the country, in terms of our weather. We have never seen a winter like this before. Half the country faces snow, ice, and those of us in the South, we're not used to that kind of climate. We're seeing record low temperatures. We're seeing frustrations because thousands are without water. They're without power. There's some political concerns over the rolling blackouts and why they're taking places in parts of our country. But the comfort we have as children of God is this: when you know God's word is true, over the facts of the moment, you have reasons to hold on. When you know that God is true to his word, even when you face harsh realities, you still have a reason to hold on. So our prayer should be in this time: Lord, help me to hold out until I see your truth come to pass. That's why we sing songs like, Lord, help me to hold out. My way may not be easy. You did not say that it would be. But when it gets dark and I can't see my way, you told me to put your trust and put my trust in you. So when you know God's word is true, hope in the truth of God's word and hold out until you see God's word come to pass, because you know God's word is true over the facts of the moment. And these verses explain two reasons why we can hope in the truth of God's word. First, God answers prayer. God answers prayer. Let's look at verses 145 through 148. With my whole heart, I cry, answer me, O Lord. I will keep your statutes. I will call to you, save me, that I may observe your testimonies. I rise before dawn and cry for help. I hope in your words. My eyes are awake before the watches of the night, that I may meditate on your promise. Notice in these verses, the psalmist is in continual prayer. The context of these verses, he's facing persecution from evildoers. Those evildoers are near him, looking to persecute him with evil purpose. Yet he prays to God in the midst of facing this persecution. And the prayer he prays is not a "now I lay me down to sleep" type prayer. Look at how he's praying to God in the midst of this persecution. First of all, he's praying fervently. See that in verse 145 where he says, "I'm calling out and crying out to God with my whole heart." He's praying intentionally in verse 146 where he says, "I call to you, save me." He's calling to God alone for salvation. He prays continually in verse 147 and 148. Notice in verse 147, he rises before dawn and cries for help. That in the wee hours of the morning, he's crying to God for help. In verse 148, he says that he's alert at the watch of the night so he can meditate on the promise of God. This psalmist is facing a growing problem where his persecution is drawing near, but he continues to pray. He knows that he's dealing with this persecution that's coming, but he chooses to pray. Why does he pray? It's found in verse 147. "I hope in your words." He hopes in God's word because he knows God's word is true. And because he knows that God's word is true, he has confidence in the word and he expresses that confidence through prayer. This is the point that we need to catch in this part of the passage. Fervent prayer is evidence of faith in God's word. Fervent prayer is evidence of faith in God's word. This is why you should not stop praying. As children of God, as disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, if you believe the word of God is true and you have confidence in the truthfulness of God's word, you cannot stop praying. I agree with Dr. Tellis Chapman, who says, "Prayer is not to inform God. Prayer is to inspire you." Prayer is not just making your requests known to God. It's standing on God's truth until it comes to pass. It's not just submitting a request and telling God what you want. It's also submitting your will and saying, "God, I'm not going to get in your way while you do what your word says you'll do." Notice as the psalmist is praying that he promises to keep God's statutes, that he's willing to ride it out with God until God performs what he said he will in his word. And that's a challenge for us because it poses the question, will you pray long enough to see God do what he said he's going to do? God is true to his word, so the question is not a matter of God's truthfulness and faithfulness to his word. The question really is, are you willing to pray until you see something happen? Oftentimes we pray our prayer, make our requests known, and then leave it alone, but don't show any sign of commitment, don't show any sign of fervor, don't show any signs of persistence because we think God didn't hear our prayer. Sometimes God is waiting for us to see if we're committed not only to praying, but praying to him to see him perform exactly what he said. We see this persistence in prayer in Luke chapter 18 with the persistent widow. Jesus tells this parable of this persistent widow who comes to an unjust judge to get justice against her adversary. The Bible says that this judge did not fear man or fear God. He did not care at all. But because of her importunity, as the King James Version says, because of her persistence, he ruled in her favor. And at the end of the parable, the Lord says in Luke chapter 18, verse 7, "And will not God give justice to his elect who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long over them?" Really what Jesus is saying is, if this unjust judge is willing to show favor to the persistent widow, how much more will God not give justice to his elect who cry to him persistently, waiting for him to do exactly what he says? So the question is, are you willing to pray until you see God do something according to his word? Are you willing to pray until something happens? Because it's not a matter of if God is faithful to his word. The question is, are you faithful to praying in him? And are you confident enough in his word to reflect it in your prayer life? Because here's the truth of God's word. As you read the Bible, as you look throughout scripture, this truth rings out. God answers prayer. That's the truth of God's word. God answers prayer. If you're faithful to him in praying, if you're confident in the truthfulness of God's word, God does not allow that faithfulness to go void. God answers prayer. We see that happen in the book of Acts as Peter is in prison. There are members of the church praying at home, and they watch Peter go from the prison gates to the house door. It's proof that God answers prayer. We even see it with Jesus at the cross as he's praying, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And as he's praying for forgiveness, it's the onset of showing that God is able to forgive even the most extreme sinners. It's proof if you call on the Lord, he will answer prayer. So don't stop praying. Stay in the race. Stay in the fight and keep on praying, because your prayer is evidence of your faith in God's word, and God's word is true, and God will answer prayer. That's why we need to have hope in the truth of God's word, because God answers prayer. Even as we're dealing with these unprecedented times, whether with weather, politics, pandemic, whatever else, even when it seems like God isn't answering prayer, God still answers prayer. We were praying for a stoppage in this pandemic and the slow spread of the coronavirus. Could it be that God uses this Arctic blast as a way to slow down the spread of coronavirus? Just because it doesn't happen in the way we want it to does not mean that God is not answering prayer. God answers prayer, and that's evidence of the truthfulness of his word. So hold out till your change comes. Because you can hope in the truth of God's word, because the truth of the matter is God answers prayer. Second reason why we need to hope in the truth of God's word is this: God's word never fails. God's word never fails. Let's look at verses 149 through 152. "Hear my voice according to your steadfast love, O Lord. According to your justice, give me life. They draw near who persecute me with evil purpose. They are far from your law. But you are near, O Lord, and all your commandments are true. Long have I known your testimonies, that you have founded them forever." Notice at this part of the passage, we're getting to the heart of what the psalmist is dealing with. He's seeking God's intervention for this evildoer. And he asks God for both justice and faithfulness as these evildoers are near. He says that they are going to persecute him with evil purpose. And he knows that their heart is evil and their purpose is evil, because he says that these individuals are far from God's law. But notice, as he's seeking intervention and as his enemies are near, he says in verse 151, that God's word is closer than those who persecute him. As evildoers draw near, they don't overpower the truth of God's word, because God's word is closer to him than the persecution of these evildoers. Their persecution cannot overpower God's promise. The psalmist knows God's word is sure, so he relies on God's word, because he knows God's word never fails. That's the confidence you have to have when you face persecuting times. If you believe in the truthfulness of God's word, if you hope in the truth of God's word, you must be confident in knowing God's word never fails. Doesn't matter what type of persecution you face, whether it's with stormy blasts, whether it's bitter cold, whether it's unsettled politics, uncertain future, if you don't know if the power's gonna come back on, You don't know what's going to happen in City Hall, the governor's mansion, or the White House. If you hope in God's word, if you have confidence in the truth of God's word, you must remember God's word never fails. That's a comfort that we have as children of God, because we can trust God's word in every situation we face. If you know God's word never fails, you can trust God's word in every situation you face. So as we deal with this winter blast, we need to be mindful of what God's word says and know that God's word never fails. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 2, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. It's evident that these times are not going to change, that we may experience this longer than we anticipate. But according to the word of God, if you have hope in God's word and you have confidence in the truthfulness of God's word, God is saying that whatever circumstance you go through, whatever season you face, I will be with you, and those seasons will not overwhelm you or consume you. It may cause you to feel some emotions. It may cause you to feel some pain, but it's not going to take you out. So when we deal with chaos, we need to be reminded of what God's word says. John chapter 14, verse 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let them be afraid. In the moment where you face fear and you feel afraid because of what's going on, God has promised you his peace, not as the world gives based on outer circumstances, but as he gives based on an inner conviction to know it is well with my soul. That's what happens when you hope in God's word. You trust in his word in every situation you face because you're constantly reminded God's word never fails. This is why you should hope in the truth of God's word. Sing as the hymn writer sings, 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. I'm so glad I've learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him over and over. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for grace to trust him more. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word tonight. Thank you for reminding us we need to hold out. We're asking you to help us to hold out as we continue to hope in the truthfulness of your word. As we have confidence in your word, we know that you answer prayer. We know that your word never fails. Convict us where we stand in need of conviction. Encourage us where we stand in need of encouragement. Pray, God, that this word go forth, edify your people, but ultimately glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank God for your presence tonight. We pray that this lesson blessed you. If you've been blessed by what you heard tonight and blessed by the ministry of Saint Rest, we'll encourage you to give as God lays on your heart to do so. There are many ways where you can contribute to the life ministry of Saint Rest. You can give physically. We have a drop box available on campus. You can also give electronically through Givelify, PayPal, Cash App, and Google Pay. Several different methods of giving, but the same mentality. God loves a cheerful giver, and I'm a witness. You cannot beat God giving, no matter how hard you try, because the more you give, I'm telling you, the more God will give to you. So if you feel led to give tonight, as the Spirit lays on your heart, we'll encourage you to give, and know that we are being good stewards of that which God blesses us through your contributions. So we're closing tonight. A couple of announcements we want to make known to our members. Please check our Facebook page, comment, and let us know how you're doing during this winter storm. It's been on my heart to check on our members, and I've tried to reach out via text and via phone call, but I want to make sure that our members are doing okay. So if you feel led to do so, Please comment on our Facebook page. There is a post there asking you to check in. Let us know how you're doing. Comment and let us know so we know how we can pray with you and also reach out to you if there are concerns in our membership. We definitely want to stay connected during these times. So please comment on the Facebook page. Let us know. And I'm encouraging members, if you feel the need to check on other members, let's call, let's reach out to our church family to make sure everybody is okay, they're safe, and they're warm during this winter blast. We also want to encourage you to take part of our worship experience this coming Sunday, where we'll begin a new series, Crosstalk. Yes, as we're approaching the Easter holiday season, this resurrection season, we want to look at conversations that took place at Calvary, the seven last sayings of our Lord before he gave his life, sacrificed it for our sins. So starting this Sunday at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning, we will begin the series Crosstalk, looking at the seven last sayings of Jesus before the crucifixion. I'm excited about the series, and I pray it blesses you as it has blessed me in the studies that have taken place so far. So closing tonight, we just want to pray for our church family as a whole. Several are dealing with sickness, dealing with issues with this winter blast, and others are dealing with other issues. You may have some issues as well that you feel led to address and want to comment on. So we encourage you, as you're watching, please comment. Let us know how we can pray with you. We believe in the power of prayer, not because of how well we pray, but because of the God to whom we pray. So let's pray as we're closing. God, thank you again for this privilege of prayer and cry out to you. We know you'll hear us and answer us. Thank you for how you've kept us through this stormy blast. These are times, these are temperatures, this is a season we're not accustomed to. But God, it did not catch you by surprise. You have been sovereign and you've been kind towards us. We thank you for it. Pray now for our church family as a whole. Continue to keep us in love, keep us in fellowship, keep us in your word. Thank you for how you're keeping us together. Pray for those who are watching tonight, those who have unspoken prayer request needs. God, you know what's happening in their hearts, in their minds, in their families, in their jobs, in their homes. Intervene in those spaces. Do as only you can do, because we know that you are a God who specializes in things that are impossible, that you are capable of doing what no other power can do. Pray, God, for our nation. Continue to keep us in your care. Watch over those who may be less fortunate, who are dealing with power outages, water outages, those who may not have a home or shelter. Have mercy on us, God. Have mercy on them. God, we pray that we be an extension of your hands, that if it's in our hands and in our hearts to do, that we'll be a blessing to those in this season as it reflects your heart and leads others to you. God, as we pray, we know you're capable of doing more than this. So now unto him who's able to do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think, according to the power at work in us, to him be glory in Christ Jesus, in the church and throughout all ages. Thank God. Amen.